So Chris Hewitt, news editor at Empire Magazine, joins me now to talk about the London Film Festival. Magic is, of course, the broadcast partner, and Empire have long been a print partner. You've got quite a rich history with the London Film Festival, haven't you?
Yeah, stretching back years and years and years, before my time at Empire. And I've been at Empire for a long time.
I mean, it's a pretty big festival now. I think it seems to have grown bigger and bigger throughout the years. How does it compare, you know, on an international scale with the likes of Cannes and Toronto and Venice?
I think it's rapidly getting up there. Its reputation is growing constantly, year on year. It's becoming a place. It's in one of the most exciting and beautiful cities on earth. It's very different in terms of its feel from the Cannes Film Festival, certainly. It's much more open to the public than Cannes is. Cannes always feels a little bit more exclusive, a little bit more shut off, a little bit more behind a velvet rope. This is much more open to the public, which is great. And the big names flock to London. They love coming here as well. And it's such a wonderful place. It's concentrated around Leicester Square, which is this wonderful hive of activity. It's got this great buzz. It's a wonderful hubbub going on all the time. It's a really, really special festival.
Yeah, it's 2 weeks of complete madness, really. I mean, sometimes you've got three gala premieres in a day, so you've got, you know, three lots of film talent up a red carpet, which is pretty busy for everyone concerned, but very exciting.
I've covered the LFF on a daily basis, making video diaries for Empire, and you would sometimes be running from one cinema to the other. Oh, Anne Hathaway's in this cinema. Oh, she's finished now. We're going to run over there because that's where George Clooney is. And that was a typical night at the LFF. It was really, really fun. I remember one year when George Clooney seemed to move into London and just didn't leave for ages. He had something like three films at the LFF that year. It's wonderful. And this year, the big names are just going to just come in right from the off. You've got the likes of Kerry Mulligan, Michael Fassbender, Bryan Cranston. It's going to be a wonderful cavalcade of A-list stars.
There is a really nice range of names and films. So first of all, let's talk about the opening and closing galas, because they're sort of like the bookends of the whole festival. Suffragette is opening.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Suffragette is the opening film at the LFF this year, and this is a very, very interesting film. It's a British film. It's a film about the suffragette movement, funnily enough. It's directed by Sarah Gavron. It's a fantastic cast, the likes of Carey Mulligan, who's definitely going to be in Oscar contention, I think, Helena Bonham Carter, Meryl Streep, very, very briefly, but brilliant, Ben Whishaw, Brendan Gleeson, incredible cast. I'm talking about the sacrifices that the suffragists went through in order to win the vote back in the day. And it's an extraordinary tale of female empowerment, but not just female empowerment, just empowerment generally, and sticking it to the man and standing up against a power and speaking truth to power. It's a fantastic film.
Talking about female empowerment, there is a running theme throughout this festival. There's a lot of focus on women in film and gender equality in film. There's a Gina Davis symposium, which is a world symposium inviting various, you know, Gina Davis herself and women in high positions all over the film industry and media industry in general, to come and talk about the pay gap that is often seen, and the fact that it's very hard to get a film made if there's a strong female lead, the lack of female directors within the industry.
Yeah, it's something that I think the industry is now addressing much more overtly than it did in the past. My mind goes back a couple of weeks ago to a shot taken on the set of Paul Feig's Ghostbusters, which had all the female cast members, and obviously it's an all-female lineup of Ghostbusters, and that shot got a lot of traction around the internet. People loved that idea as well. And I think the same thing with, you know, Suffragette. It's a very female-led movie. It's a female director, female writer, mostly female cast, and it's really going to strike a blow right from the off. Gina Davis is coming in for a talk as well about the role of women in film. There's a lot of female-led movies. Carol, which is one of the Oscar frontrunners with Cate Blanchett and Rooney Mara in performances that could well garner them both Oscar nominations. That's one of the highlights of the lineup for me. There's also Saoirse Ronan in Brooklyn, which is another great female performance. I think it's definitely something that the LFF is highlighting this year, and rightly so.
And Kate Winslet's character in the movie Steve Jobs, which closes the London Film Festival, and she plays a female character, one of the only female characters who stood up to Steve Jobs. I can't wait for this film. It's been talked about, and who was going to play Steve Jobs. It's Michael Fassbender. What do you know about it?
We know that Steve Jobs is going to be fascinating. It's going to be a very interesting experience, because it was written by Aaron Sorkin, and who's a genius behind The West Wing, and he wrote the script for The Social Network and A Few Good Men. He's just a phenomenal writer. And he wrote the piece not as a traditional biopic, but he decided to focus in on three key events in Steve Jobs' life. So three presentations that he made at key points in his life. Not the iPad, not the iPhone, not none of that stuff. So we're talking about the first Mac. We're talking about the next computer that he launched when he was when he had left Apple at one point. We're talking about things like that. And we're and within those, he's dramatized encounters with people in his life, both personally and from a business point of view. And it's a no-holds-barred take on Steve Jobs. It's not a hagiography in any way. It doesn't gloss over the man's rough edges. He was a genius, but he was very, very difficult to work with. And from what we know, from what we understand of the film, it's brilliantly directed. It's fantastically acted by Michael Fassbender. Danny Boyle approaches it in very, very interesting ways. He shot each of the three parts using a different film stock to show the different time periods, and it's going to feel like a very cinematic tale, despite the fact that the script came in very dialogue heavy at about 200 pages. But it's going to feel like a cinematic experience. I'm really excited about it. Yeah. Steve Jobs is one of those people. He's had such an impact on our culture and on the way we live today. And so I think this is a movie that's going to be worthy of him in that way. I think it's going to be a movie touched with genius.
I can't wait. I really can't wait. And in between the opening and closing, there are some incredible films, some really big names coming to town. You've already mentioned some of them. And I know that you've really kindly, you and the guys at Empire, have kind of curated a list of some of the films that Magic listeners, you know, as we are a broadcast partner, we've got tickets to give away, that they might be interested in going and seeing and be excited by.
Yeah, there's a ton of great films at this year's LFF. So apart from the ones I've already mentioned, Steve Jobs, Suffragette, Carol, Brooklyn, some incredible films coming as well. So we have the likes of Black Mass, in which Johnny Depp finally returns to form. He's had a bit of a rough patch as an actor, although I have a soft spot for Mordecai.
yeah, me too.
He plays a real-life gangster called Whitey Bulger in this, and it's a real physical transformation for him. A lot of people are linking him with a possible Best Actor nomination.
At last. Wow.
Well, he's been nominated in the past. He's never won.
No.
But this could be the one. I'm not sure if he'll win this year, but this could be definitely the one to get him a nomination again. There's also the likes of Idris Elba in Beasts of No Nation, which is a very, very interesting film. It's a very, very searing, coruscating epic about a young man, a young boy in Africa who's taken under the wing of a warlord played by Idris Elba, and it doesn't hold back, and it really delves deep into the horrors of war. And this is interesting as well because it's actually been bought by Netflix, so it's going to be available very, very soon for people to see in the comfort of their own living rooms.
Can we talk about Lady in the Van?
We can.
Because I can't wait for that.
Yeah, The Lady in the Van is something I've got my eye on. I think this is, it feels weird to say, gives someone a showcase when they're a dame and when they've got an acting career stretching back decades. But I think this is really going to give Dame Maggie Smith, who plays The Lady in the Van. It's based on a real life story of a lady who lived in a van, a homeless lady, who lived in Alan Bennett's driveway, and their strange relationship between the two of them that they struck up over a number of years. I think it's really going to really drive it home that this is one of our true acting greats. There's more to Dame Maggie Smith than Harry Potter for a lot of people, which I think how a lot of people, especially this generation, will know her.
Absolutely. Latin Downton,
obviously, yeah. And they'll be inspired then to maybe seek out some of the stuff she did in the past.
Definitely. It just looks so warm and touching and funny and everything you just love about a good British film.
Absolutely. It's directed by Nicholas Heitner as well, who's a fantastic director. And I'm really, really looking forward to it. I think it's going to be very, 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 very soft, but very acerbic in an Alan Bennett way.
And Trumbo, I'm excited by, just purely because I love Bryan Cranston. Tell us a bit more about that film.
Speaking of great writers. Trumbo is a fascinating film. It is the tale of Dalton Trumbo, who was a screenwriter, an Oscar-winning screenwriter, who was blacklisted during the McCarthyism era in America because he essentially was linked with communism and wouldn't give up any of his friends and wouldn't turncoat, essentially, and blab. And so it's a tale of how he was blacklisted by Hollywood. He's played by Bryan Cranston in a phenomenal performance. Bryan Cranston, I think, is one of the greatest actors on the planet. And I think this shows a different side to him than Walter White. And it's fascinating. Also, it's directed by Jay Roach, who directed the Austin Powers movies. This is a complete 180 for him. Mm. And it seems to be taking his career into a different direction. And he and Cranston have just teamed up on a biopic of, well, not a biopic necessarily, but it's a film about Lyndon B. Johnson called All the Way, which is based on a play that Cranston won a Tony for on Broadway about a year ago.
We can't talk about all the films in the festival, unfortunately, because we just haven't got time. So let's talk about Empire's own gala film. It's called High Rise.
Yeah, we're very excited about this. We chose as our Empire Gala this year on October 9th. Do come along if you can get tickets. High Rise Ben Wheatley's High Rise. Ben Wheatley is a fantastic filmmaker, a real friend of the magazine. We love his work. He's the guy who directed Down Terrace, Kill List, Sightseers, and A Field in England. This is his first adaptation of someone's work. It's based on a J.G. Ballard novel of the same name, High Rise, set in the 1970s. And it's about the weird primal devolution of a group of people who live in a high-rise building in London in the 1970s. And something happens that essentially makes them shut themselves off from the outside world and just refer to primal instincts, and it becomes one long, horrendously violent, very decadent party. And at its core, we have Tom Hiddleston as Dr. Robert Lang, who's a very detached person who observes the human wreckage in front of him. We have Luke Evans, who's fantastic in the film, as Wilder, who's a documentarian who's very wild indeed, and he really gives into his worst urges. It's a fantastic, phenomenal cast as well. You have Sienna Miller, Jeremy Irons, Elizabeth Moss. You have some of Ben Wheatley's regular players in there as well. You have the likes of Reese Shearsmith. Wonderful, wonderful cast, and it's a really, really gripping film. It's very darkly funny. It's blackly comedic. It's got all the Ben Wheatley hallmarks, but it's got a much bigger scope than in his previous work, and his themes, his thematic preoccupations link up very nicely with Ballard's as well, and it's wonderful to look at as well. Very, very entertaining, very dark.
Very clever piece of filmmaking.
Very clever piece of filmmaking.
Yeah, well, I saw the trailer and I was like, wow, this looks bizarre, but I was intrigued, so yeah.
Yeah, it's absolutely in Ben Wheatley's wheelhouse. If you like any of his previous movies, then do go and see this one. It's a film you really have to see. It's got some stuff in it which is so off the wall and so dark and so disturbing, but so deeply, weirdly funny at the same time, that I think you might well question your own attitudes to life and certain things afterwards after seeing it.
Yeah, the thing is, what I love about the London Film Festival is that with my job, and I'm sure it's very different for you, but I always have to see the big blockbusters and the big films that, you know, that everybody's talking about. But what this brings you is makes you realise how many levels of films there are out there, and how rich and clever and unique film can be.
Mm. Oh, it's fantastic. If you want to immerse yourself in cinema, London Film Festival is the place to do it. There's so many different strands. There's so many. It's not just about American and British films. There's world cinema strands. There's documentaries. There are talks. There are symposiums. Gina Davis, as we mentioned, is over there. Christopher Nolan is also going to be giving a talk at some point. There's some incredible talent. It's not just about coming to see the A-listers, although they will be there in droves. Mm. I'll be running around with a net trying to catch a few of them. But yeah, it's just wonderful. And it's been incredible to watch it become bigger over the last few years as well. You know, I think previously you would talk about the world's great film festivals and you would talk about Cannes and Toronto and Venice. I think the London Film Festival is now worthy of being grouped with those festivals as well.
Thank you very much for talking to us, Chris.
Thank you.